He is perhaps the most misunderstood, misrepresented, maltreated, and maligned person on the face of the earth. But that only is the stuff that makes him love all the more. He loves his enemies. He lives for the sake of others. And no cost is too great in order to bring back the family of God. He has committed his life to restoring us to God's true love, God's true life, and true lineage, so that we look upon each other as brothers and sisters, one family under God.
Welcome to Chosen. So glad you are here tonight to join us as we come together to learn more of God's word, especially God's word in terms of true parents, how they have come to fulfill the mission given unto them that this world might live in the kingdom of God. Tonight, we're going to hear again from Dr. Tyler Hendricks as he addresses for us the principle of creation. This is going to be his third presentation. And tonight, he's taking us to the point of recognizing the purpose of creation and the roadmap of life. It's great. But at this time, I'd like to invite to pray for us, Evangelist Rita Pritchett. Evangelist Pritchett, if you will come forward, we'll be glad to hear you.
Rita?
I'm here. Yes, thank you, Reverend Rico. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are in this great, wonderful day of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God evening to all of you. We start our prayer this morning. We want to say thank you, Lord, that you have equipped us to do the mighty work by your divine presence within the self of us through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you that you chose us. You chose us at the very foundation of the earth. You chose us. You chose us, and you appointed us so that you might go within the self of us to go forth in this nation and bear good fruit, that good fruit that will last, so that whatever we may ask in your name, you, Father, you will give it to us. Father, you chose us in Christ Jesus before the creation of the world. You created us to be holy and blameless in your sight. We are a chosen people. You said in your word that we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, that we are your special possession, and you gave us that marching order so that we could declare your praises. Because why? Because it was you who brought us out of darkness into the marvelous light. And we say so much to you this evening, Father. Thank you so much for choosing us. You chose us because in choosing us, we are linked to your love. You have chosen us because we will be so gracious in receiving your graciousness and your character that you have given us. You've chosen us and not we ourselves out of your loving kindness and tender heart for us. Lord, we thank you so much that you chose us so that we could go forth and do the work in this world, to walk in Amen. The path of right useness, Lord, so that we can stand upright before you and be in right standing with you. And so we thank you so much for the teachers tonight. I pray in the mighty, matchless name of Jesus that you will open their spiritual trumpets of the ears to those who are listening to really hear, and in hearing, listen, hear, and obey, and then move at the unction of the Holy Spirit. Yes, we're so careful, Father, to give your name the praise, the glory, the honor throughout all of eternity. And each and every grateful heart says amen.
Amen. Aren't you all? Praises be to God. Thank you, Evangelist Rita Pritchett. And thank you, Dr. Rayco Jenkins, for helping us out with the sound tonight on time. We thank God for the Women in Ministry of the American Clergy Leadership Conference. So often and every day are they leading the way. Right now, we're going on the path to happiness with Dr. Tyler Hendricks. Everybody, open your ears. a close attention for each one of us. Dr. Hendricks.
Hello, I'm Dr. Tyler Hendricks, and I welcome you to our discussion of God's purpose of creation. In this world, nothing exists without a purpose. All things are created beings, and their creator had some purpose for creating them. The creator's purpose becomes the purpose of the created entity. Thus, our purpose as human beings is also determined by the Creator God, His purpose for creating us. We're going to study our purpose, why we are here, in light of God's purposes. And we can know of God's purpose of creation through the Bible. Its first book, Genesis, includes God's act of creation. Whenever God finished one stage of creation, He said, "It is good." This means it makes me happy to look at this. At the last stage, the creation of human beings, God said, "It is very good." So God felt a lot of joy. Why does a person feel joy? Joy comes when we are stimulated by someone or something who looks, acts, and thinks like we do. It comes when we are in familiar surroundings, like our home. It comes when we create something that reflects who we are. When we're stimulated by something that is like us, we feel joy. And then we love those object partners who give us joy. The intangible God is the same way. Actually, He has an uncontrollable urge to love object partners who look like Him and look like her. In order to fulfill this, there has to be a tangible object. Without a substantial object partner, no one, not even God, can realize joy and feel love. Only with this object partner can God love and be happy. And God's object partner feels loved and is happy also. So that's why it's win-win. Lots of love, lots of happiness. That's why the creation began. Because happiness comes through the substantial object partner that returns joy to us. The intangible God created all this variety of the whole universe with this purpose for joy. Human beings are the children of God who resemble Him completely. We are His companions of love. Then when does God feel the most happiness? It was when He created Adam and Eve, His children, when what He conceived as an idea was fulfilled. God created us according to His form and shape. In other words, God is the parents of humanity, our father and our mother. And just like our parents are so happy when a baby is born, so too God was joyful when His children were born. God is the happiest when we resemble His form and shape, when we realize His purposes for creating us. Then what are those purposes? God, our parents, created us and gave us blessings. In Genesis 1:28, we read, "God blessed them and said to them, 'Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground.'" What does this mean? To be fruitful means for each of us to complete our individuality. It means to resemble God's divine nature and character. It means that centered on God's love, your mind and body must fulfill give and receive action with each other within you, based on your conscience and your heart. You have to have God's wholeness and fulfill his and her values, God's values. In the Bible, they call Jesus the incarnation of God's Word. He is recorded as the one who became one with God. And so Jesus said, if you see me, you see the Father. Jesus gave tremendous joy and happiness to God. Now, to increase in number and fill the earth means for those who have fulfilled their individual maturity, like Jesus, to marry and have children and expand from a family into a tribe, nation, and world. This, in other words, means the completion of the family. In Genesis 1:27, it says that God created man in his image, male and female, he created them. This means that the harmonious unification of male and female is the image of God. Genesis 2:24 states that husband and wife are to become one flesh. And Jesus repeated this in Matthew 19. Men were born for women. Women were born for men. And Jesus said, what God has put together, let no man cast asunder. The oneness of male and female is the form of God. The husband can meet God through his wife, and the wife can meet God through her husband. Through the oneness of husband and wife, children are born. And through the birth of children, the couple becomes parents, and the children become brothers and sisters. Thus, the family comprises four loves: the love of parents, the love of husband and wife, the love of children, and the love of brother and sister. Today, you and I can build a heaven with these four kinds of love in our family. A community where this love spreads to your neighbors. A world where all people serve God as their parents and consider all humanity as their brothers and sisters. This is the ideal of God. This is the purpose for which God created us, right? In Genesis 1. Finally, God said, subdue the earth, have dominion over it, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over every living creature that moves on the ground. What does this mean? It means for human beings to care for all things with love. Now, there are environmentalists who see this verse and they say, well, Christianity has had in the mindset of destroying nature. But to care for nature means for God's sons and daughters to help the creation fulfill its true nature. It means to reveal our object partner's value, the creation's value. It means to face all things with the heart of God. That is when natural things in the universe respond to us and bless us. It is an approach of loving nature, not destroying it. It means to develop and preserve nature with love, not to abuse and misuse and exploit the environment and the ecosystem. This is the extremely important insight of unification theory and Reverend Moon's own life, to take care of the creation, to take care of the oceans, to take care of all of God's creatures. It provides the basics of environmental ethics, the ecosystem theology. In unification theory, it says, after God created human beings, he gave us these three blessings. These are blessings that came to us by grace, but at the same time, they are our purpose and our responsibility. God is happiest when we fulfill these three blessings. The fulfillment of these three blessings is the perfect image of God. The way we can make God happy is through fulfilling these three blessings. The best example of this is everyone's parents. When their child is born, parents always hope for good health of the child's body and soul, and hope that they will meet a good husband or wife and have a good life. Parents feel the most joy when their children fulfill these things. God's motive for creation was the exact same. He felt the exact same way. And he made them into these three blessings. This is the purpose of creation. And it's a roadmap for human life. A world where this purpose is fulfilled is heaven on earth. It's one great family in a world under God. The unification theory's ideal is to actualize heaven on earth right here, right now, here and now. Let us fulfill the three great blessings, live happy lives, and bless the world. But how can we have good reciprocal relationships? Sounds great, but how can we decide what has value and what doesn't? What is good? What's not good? These can be tough problems, and in our next session, we're going to address these questions. Thank you so much for your attention. God bless you.
Now let us enjoy from Bishop Hezekiah Walker.
This is my testimony, everybody. How God favored me in spite of my enemies. And if God did it for me, he'll do the same thing for you. Don't worry about your haters. Your haters can't do nothing with you. Listen to these words.
Love is patient, caring. Love is kind.
Love is felt most.
Love is felt most
when it's genuine.
But I
had my share
of love abuse.
Manipulated. And his strength,
misused.
And I can't help but to give God glory. When I think about my story, oh yeah, y'all, I got a story to tell. And I know you favored me. Because my enemies, they did try, but they couldn't triumph over me. Yes, they did try, but it didn't work. I'm still here. I'm still alive. I'm still blessed. On my way to my destiny, because the favor of God is on my life. Let me tell you about love.
Love is patient. Caring.
Love is kind.
Love
is felt most
when it's genuine.
I had a whole lot of people in my life who abused my love. They manipulated it and took the strength of it and tried to misuse it. But I can't help but to give God glory today. When I think about all I've been through, and I still came out on the winning side. I don't know about you, but I know that he favored me. Because
my enemies
they did try. Sing it, y'all. But they couldn't triumph over me. Because great is he that is in me than he that's in the world. That's what they did. That's what they did. They told a whole lot of lies. But God favored me.
My character.
My integrity.
My faith in God. He favors me.
But it would not
fall.
Would not bend.
Will not bend.
Won't compromise. God favors me. I spoke life and prosperity. I even spoke health. He favored me.
They whispered about me.
They conspired against me. They told a whole lot of lies on me, but God favored me. My character,
my integrity,
my faith in God, He favored me. It will not fall, not gonna bend,
won't compromise.
God favors
me. I speak
prosperity,
and I speak health. God favors me.
They whisper.
They conspired.
They told their lies. But God favored me.
My character.
My integrity.
My faith in God.
Everything was in question. But He favored me.
Will not fail.
I promised Him that I wouldn't compromise. Although I was going through.
I spoke life.
And I spoke prosperity.
And I spoke health.
Creation, God's intentional favor in the universe. Hallelujah. Genesis, the first chapter, verse 27 and 28 from the Bible describes heavenly parent God in mankind in self-image, both male and female. And blessed them to multiply and rule the earth. This passage has been interpreted in various ways throughout history and by different religious traditions. Dr. Tyler Hendricks, in his presentation 3 on the principle of creation from the perspective of true parents, has brought the purpose of creation and the roadmap of life with emphasis that God created humanity with a specific purpose and that each person has a unique path to fulfill their purpose. This idea aligns with the study Marie and I have done through per Wesleyan Bible's Wesleyan commentary on Genesis 1, verse 27 through 28, which stresses that humans were created in God's image to reflect His and her goodness and to be caretakers. Where are you in your digestion of creation, the purpose of creation? How has it informed your roadmap for life? I am Bishop Dr. Luonne Abram Rouse, and my expression of creation as existence, intentional expansion into various ways of existing in thoughts, feelings, and behaviors to maximize the properties in the universe as another layer of interpretation. What is the layer that you are adding? For me, I place this layer in what I term the theology of intentionality, where for our Rouse couple, a parent has intention in our knowledge. Get this. You can listen, take this and digest it. Get it? And if you're not ready to state it on your own, you can just say, get that Luonne Rouse, because he's the one who's brought this from his layer theology of intentionality. Here it is, that he intends for us in our house to have the knowledge in eye view in and ears hearing of the only begotten daughter. That's right. I'm proclaiming it, acknowledging it, and witnessing to it because we have come to experience her. According to this view, creation is intentional and purposeful, with each aspect of existence serving a particular function. The properties in the universe that can be maximized include physical properties like energy, Dr. Hendricks spoke of, matter, and space, as well as metaphysical properties like love and joy. Therefore, I come to speak to you tonight in response to such a great presentation and say the only begotten daughter in the Rouse House and beyond calls for all people on earth to share one family in true love, that of joy, peace, kindness, goodness, patience, gentleness, and self-control, against which there is no law, and all its crimes cease. In conclusion, these interpretations of Genesis, the first chapter, the 27th through the 28th verse, emphasize the significance of humanity's purpose and responsibility in the world, by also acknowledging the intentional nature of creation and the diversity of the properties within the universe. You see, as true mother, the only begotten daughter, Dr. Hachahan Moon, has said over and over again and teaches, is it? The owner of the universe is our heavenly parent, God. Thank you for being with us tonight and hearing my commentary with that of Dr. Tyler Hendricks and the presentation of the knowledge and the teachings of true parents. To help us further understand this, we have family members with us tonight who are going to join us on the screen to talk for a while. And one of them is Bruce Brodner, who is the director of the World Christian Leadership Conference. Bruce, I hope I have that right. Yeah, I've been away from you, haven't been with WCLC for about 3 weeks or whatever that is. And I hope I'm on point with who you doing with WCLC. How are you tonight?
I am well. You know, I'm amazed. I mean, I could just sit here and reflect on these words. I can listen to these words for all of eternity. It reminds me of someone said, if we got a glimpse into heaven, just a little, like there was a little crack in a fence we could look through, we would be fixated on that for hundreds of years. We could be. And I think this message tonight, certainly unpacked by Dr. Hendricks, reminds me of that sliver, that where we get a chance to look into God's mind. You know, God's mind. You know, we've made God, we've placed God so far away, We said our thoughts are not his thoughts are not our, you know, many things, you know, things like we can't be perfect, we're only human beings. And we've lived like this for so long, knowing, believing, you know, that we're really not in the image and likeness of God. I mean, we, our emotions, you know, maybe our intellect might want it, but our emotions say it's not possible. So we have a dichotomy in our between our thinking, our feeling, our original desires, this hope that someday we you know, we get a book, we want to unpack the book, we want to learn, we want to emulate, we want to become. And then we have these other thoughts, never will happen. It'll never happen. It can't happen. It won't happen. And so we're constantly in this battle. And, you know, as I'm just hearing these words, which I've heard many times before, it just is so clear. You know, we are created in the image and likeness of God. You know, there's an old saying, God doesn't make junk, right? You know, so, you know, we are, you know, and this whole idea that God's joy comes through this relationship with me, with seeing me, you know, it reminds me of a parent, you know, that's loving their child. And the child can't really respond in love, but it responds in this other thing called beauty. And that beauty is so stimulating to the parent. The first steps, the first words, you know, the first, you know, sentence, you know, I remember my son, you know, his first sentence was, he was running around, and I grabbed him and I held him up over my head. And his first sentence was, calm down, Dad, calm down. You know, and I'm thinking, who is this kid, you know? I guess he heard those words from his mother over and over. Calm down, Preston. Somehow he knew it was, I can, you know. But when I heard, first of all, I thought this kid was from Mars. I didn't, you know, that was his first sense. I thought, well, I have a long ways to go with this one. But it's amazing to just recognize the joy that we were created to give God by fulfilling the three great blessings. By fulfilling and maturing where our mind is really connected to God and our body is responding to the directions and directive of our mind. And as we train and as we mature and, you know, then it's not just our mind has godly thoughts and, you know, and we're thinking of goodness and, but our body is also very connected to that. You know, so I think, you know, God, we say, you know, image. So we say we have God's image or we're created in his image. Well, it's not physical. You know, God is not physical. God is a spirit. But his image, his nature, his character, as you mentioned, character is embedded in us. There is, and I oftentimes say this, I said, you know, we have one job. We only have one job in our life. And we can do all kinds of things, but we have one job. And that's to reflect the one aspect of God's infinite nature that I possess. That's my only job. I have to be able to express that only one aspect. And that one aspect can give God infinite joy or joy from that one, seeing his own nature expressed in me. That's what parents are looking for. We're looking for the nose of our child, you know? Oh, he has my nose. He has this. Yeah, and we're always looking to identify some nature or external property that this child has. I think God's the same. He's wanting to see his identity wrapped up in us. And when he sees it, he's excited. He's joyful, you know? So I just feel like the message we heard today was just, I mean, it is deep. And, you know, we just, celebrated Father's Day. And I was a late bloomer. You know, we have our first and only child, you know, after, and here he is calling me. It's funny. And I'll have to call him right back. I know he's, but he, you know,
right on time,
you know. And, you know, I was thinking, we waited 20 years for having a child, my wife and I. So my wife and I were really a couple, just a couple. But when this little guy came into our life, this couple became a family. I became a father. My wife became a mother. And this little child did all of this for us. So I was thinking, when God had Adam and Eve, he also became a father and a mother and a parent and a family. How much he loved Adam and Eve, how much he wanted them to grow and mature. So you know, that is really, I think our feelings, our experience is not different than God's, because it's universal. And whatever is universal in us is going to be the origin, will be within God.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen. I too thank
you
for those wonderful remarks, wonderful responses. You stay with us if you can.
I will.
Speak to your son for a moment, but if you do, come back.
I will do it right away.
But right now, we have Minister Yuka Samata. She is, I know for sure, the administrator for the American Leadership Conference, among the other things in life that she has going on. And she's going to talk to us right now, Yuka, about what's going on in your roadmap of life, as you understand it, Dr. Hendricks' perspective.
Okay. Hello. Thank you, Dr. Rouse. Okay, so I think first thing I got from Dr. Tyler Hendricks' message was simply say to make God happy. And as a parent, God, when God see us children, and when we go resembling God, God can feel joy and happiness. So I think my roadmap, I'm still single. So I want to be more mature myself. I want to grow my heart and my love towards God and my family as well. So I want to be more mature, close to public myself, and I want to build a beautiful family, but not just my own family, but from there, I want to expand that to community and the world. And then with the foundation of beautiful family, right? We want to serve for the world. So, and hopefully as I fulfilling those three blessings, I can resemble God's nature. So I think that's my roadmap for life.
Yeah, everybody needs a roadmap. And I'm glad that you are maturing into yours. Martin Luther King Jr., one of his most powerful messages to young people was his speech on them having a roadmap. When listening to you tonight, you reminded me of a teaching that we have in Christianity that is about maturity, Christian maturity, we call it. And it ultimately aims at having young people who are young in the experience of the awareness of God, that through the faith experience of those who have come to know God through Jesus Christ, we have what we call marks of Christian. And the marks of a Christian is faith, hope, and love. These are, and of course, according to the word in from the letter attributed to the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 13th verse, the greater of these three is love. And when I hear you talk about the maturity and in these days and months and years with the unification faith community, oh, how outstanding it is, even blessed with this, as who is a second generation, one who's born into this, to mature in your understanding of absolute faith, absolute life, absolute love is outstanding. So thank you for not rushing your process or trying to discover something on your own, but trusting God to mature you in the genuineness of your faith, that love might be true, your life might be true, and your obedience to God may be true. Absolutely. Thank you, Yuka. Thank you for all that you are already doing for us. And like I said, don't let us push you too hard. You let us know when we need to slow it down. But tonight we have one who has been a teacher of maturity in many things in life. And I'm just going to ask her to come to respond as she might desire tonight. And that's the Reverend Susan Befferman. Susan, it's yours.
Oh, you know, I love these teachings. It just stimulates creativity and memories from all the experiences we had with Father and Mother Moon. And I love teaching the divine principle. So I just want to start out by saying, you know, God is unchanging. So his desire, his hope, his wish at the beginning is unchanged all through human history and will be the same at the end. And I think not everybody thinks about that. Not enough of our believers ask themselves, well, what did God want at the beginning? Because still some people try to convince me that God allowed the fall because he figured we needed to suffer so he could send Jesus. I mean, Jesus would not agree with that at all. So the Alpha and the Omega has to be the same. And if Adam and Eve had not fallen, Jesus could have taken a vacation. So, of course, our purpose in life and how to discover what is my individual purpose in life, it's the same for all of us. Those three blessings are precious. But the reality of trying to fulfill it is tough. And once upon a time, Father Moon said, originally, all of you should reach perfection and then get blessed in marriage and have unity between husband and wife and then have children and then work on creating the kingdom of heaven on earth. He said, but we can't wait. We have to fulfill all three blessings at one time because God is suffering. His heart is aching and the enemy has got combat boots on and he's crushing all the loving people in the world and bringing wars and what have you, trying to end God's dominion. Of course, that's folly. So all of us are even more imperfect because we're trying to fulfill all three blessings at once. But if you get hold of the first one, then my individual perfection is an ongoing process. And frankly, my desire to reach perfection came from God. My desire to have an object to love came from God. My desire, my desperate longing to have children came from God. And when we have that family of love, flawed, but never mind. Everybody's doing their best. But when we have that family of love and we embrace one another, then that love just kind of bubbles over. It overflows onto other people. And then they're involved and embraced by our loving family. And then there's a community of loving. And then naturally we take care of the world we live in. And so how we care for the creation is actually our avocation. Some, it's a profession. Naturally, the love we have in our family causes us to long to create that beauty and harmony all around us. If my house is not clean or at least orderly, I'm not at peace. Mm. So I'm teaching my grandkids how to put everything back where they found it. And so as we're all, as a community of faith, a community of God's true love, are working together, helping each other grow. And, you know, we might mention some little place where we could improve, or we recognize that we hurt someone, and so we apologize. And that's all part of learning to live for the sake of others, which is our mantra in the unification movement. It's just an extension of what Jesus said, you know, love your neighbor as yourself. So that powerful three blessings is how I can be happy, my family can be happy, my community, my backyard, my neighborhood, my city, my state, and my nation, when all of us can really focus on living for the sake of others, then that is our purpose for living. That is our source of joy. And just one little point I want to add is when husband and wife come together, Father Moon said, it's thunder and lightning when it's the first time. And God made it that way. Because when God unites in love with his love object, his children, he explodes. And there's stars and sparklers and, you know, all kinds of cosmic goings on. And God wants us to experience that to the depth of our soul. And so imperfect love or selfish love or sexual misconduct, it never satisfies. Only that cosmic explosion with God in the union of husband and wife is satisfying fully. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Powerful, meaningful, direct teaching of God and God's good creation. Thank you, too, for your experience of true parents and sharing with us in that experience, that time with Father Moon. That means so much. I love, too, that tonight, those of you who have come from various walks within it, and one who has confessed maturing in it, could bring to us the understanding that God's three great blessings ought to be, as the marks of Christianity, the marks upon our heart of human responsibility. Powerful. So let us hold on to those and remember that God, our owner of the universe, our heavenly parent, has right in the first verse of Genesis 1, allowed it to be authored, these eight attributes of who heavenly parent really is. Right there in the first verse, we'll study those at another time. But what's important for us to take away tonight is 27 and 28. So God created humankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. What a human responsibility we have. We are responsible too for loving one another. Let us show some love towards Reverend Dr. Mark Hernandez, who wanted to be with us, and then plane delay after plane delay after plane delay. And he finally said to us, I will not make it, but his spirit is here with us. We're going to close in prayer tonight as we began in prayer tonight. I'm going to call on one of the women in ministry who's always ready to talk with God. That's Reverend Merlin Katulik. If you will open your mic, and tonight, dear minister, give us the closing word and the closing prayer. Reverend Merlin.
Thank you, Dr. Rouse, and to all my colleagues tonight. I am just so delighted to be with you all tonight and know that God called each one of us and to fulfill our God-given desires and responsibilities, knowing that God dwells within us by the power of the Holy Spirit, and knowing that He is dwelling in us. We have a family, we have a marriage, we have children, we have grandchildren. I have great-grandchildren, so I'm really blessed, four generations. And it's just delight, really, for me to be around all of you with like minds, because I truly see God in all of you. And I'm just delighted to know that we together can continue to do the work unto the Lord, because He's empowered us. He's ordained this time for us to acknowledge Him, not only in nature, but in our families and our marriages. And we together will continue to do the greater work for the glory of God. Thank you tonight for the words of all my colleagues prior to this time. And I want to thank each and every one of you. And together we'll continue to expand the kingdom of God, which is right now, right here, right now. And that is wonderful to know that we can do this. Come this far, and He said He's Alpha and Omega. So we have a beginning and an end. And that life is eternal forevermore. So that's exciting to know. Let us pray. Our gracious eternal Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. By the divine inspiration of the Holy Spirit of the living God. And we thank you for your word came forth tonight in power and in demonstration of your Spirit. And we thank you for that. We attend it to our hearts, Father God, and we want to expel it in our lives. And we thank you for the American Clergy Leadership Conference. We thank you for our true parents. We thank you for our heavenly parents. And together we will continue to go forth as a mighty instrument for your glory. We thank you for your word is alive and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. And your word, hallelujah, is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And knowing this, we together can accomplish all things. Thank you that you have delegated that authority for us to use. And we will take dominion and do the things that you've called us to do in your holy, precious name. Thank you for tonight. Thank you for every participant. And thank you for your word that came forth tonight. These things we decree and declare in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, in all of our names as blessed and free families of the Lord. And we pray in Jesus Christ's name. Amen and Aji.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Katulik.
God bless you all.
Thank you, Minister Yuka. Thank you, Reverend Rodner. Thank you, Evangelist. Thank you, Dr. Rachel Jenkins. Hey, listen, everybody who is tonight and those who may listen otherwise, recording. You.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rouse.
Thank you, Dr. Rouse. Thank you, everybody.
Have a great night, everybody.
Thank you,
Dr. Rouse.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Gail. God bless you all.
Good night. Thank you, Yuka-san.
Thank you.
Night.
Have a great evening.